make your choices such that they do not lead down irreversible paths that may be in error. To choose on the side of resiliency over brittleness, to make sure that there's more than one way to achieve a goal, is I would urge each of those efforts to appoint someone to be the official curmudgeon, whose job it is to repeatedly say, what else could go wrong? What have we not thought about? What are we so sure about that if we're wrong, we're really in trouble? And an officially appointed curmudgeon who is there all the time, just poking the balloon of arrogance that we all have, that we know how to manage this stuff right, I think that would be one of the funnest jobs ever.
The concept of modification is one which spans human history, modification of the environment and natural surroundings. In modern times, modification has taken a turn into an untested, unknown realm. Right under our noses, genetically modified foods such as corn, wheat, soy, and a host of other staple grain products are being genetically enhanced in ways that surely have not been tested long term, yet are sold at grocery stores nationwide. In the same breath, right above our heads, a different type of modification is taking place, one which encompasses the entire natural environment. Something humans have dreamed of doing for thousands of years, weather modification. In the course of our investigation, we have uncovered nothing less than a real-life, real-world, real-time experiment being conducted on the populations of the world. GMO foods and weather modification programs that just a few years ago would be considered science fiction. As it turns out, it's not some wild sci-fi conspiracy. Instead, daily, the people of the world have been unwillingly subjected to a fully modified society. Food is an essential part of survival. Without it, problems arise. As the debate continues on how to feed the world, some see the concerns of overpopulation and climate change as the pathway to introduce genetically modified foods as a solution to our problems of an ever-changing planet. On the other side of the spectrum, a concerned citizenry advocates going back to the roots of agriculture, growing organic, stewardship of the land, and embracing modern technology to be able to provide fresh organic foods to the world. The GMO organic debate has picked up steam over the last few years, thanks to California's Proposition 37, seeking labeling of genetically modified foods. After months of debate and millions of dollars spent, Prop 37 failed, but re-energized the debate on both sides. To get a better understanding of why this issue is so important, I went back to my alma mater, Western Illinois University, and spoke to Dr. Joel Gruver to better understand this debate.
My name is Dr. Joel Gruver. I teach in the School of Agriculture. I teach all the soil science classes, as well as several conservation classes, including a class called Intro to Sustainable Agriculture and a class called Soil and Water Conservation. I think that my message isn't that everyone should become a farmer. My message is that everyone should be thoughtful about how they access the products of agriculture. Eating is something we all do every day, but there is, too little thought that goes into where did that food come from? What's the human dimension that result or dimensions that resulted in the production of that food, the transport, the processing? So that's part of the disconnect. What we see surrounding us is this vast sea of agricultural raw materials, corn and soybeans being produced. Few people can do it better than our Illinois farmers. But people don't feel an attachment to corn and soybeans. And so that's one of the reasons why there's this disconnect. We see corn and soybeans as something that is far removed from the plate, which is true. And so some of the current initiatives where mainstream agriculture is trying to reclaim a place in the public consciousness, some of it's a little misguided. When Illinois farmers say, I'm growing your food, it's really not true. And so we need to be accurate about what we're doing. We're producing raw materials, large amounts of them, more efficiently than we've ever done it before, but we do still have significant environmental problems that we're creating. We have ethical issues, to some extent today, being framed more and more by people who are not directly involved in agriculture. That creates problems when people frame the issue but aren't in the issue. It's a paradox that we are faced with right now, that the understanding of agriculture is something that to some extent requires a connection to the people who do it. There's great eloquence coming out of the mouths of people like Michael Pollan about agriculture, but it doesn't replace the direct connection of knowing that your dad or your grandfather or some relative produces crops, does it in the way that they feel is best, and they're not just an automaton in some industrial agricultural machine. They're not just a pawn of an industrial ag company like Monsanto. They're real people. They love their children. They take pride in what they do. At the same time, there are serious issues facing agriculture that should be critically examined. It's just difficult to do that critical examination if you don't understand the humanity that underlies agriculture as it's practiced today. Agriculture involves people. The cultural side of agriculture inherently has social dimensions. And people in agriculture, while they are business people, they also are people that are willing to take a level of they're willing to make sacrifices that almost no other type of producer in the world would be willing to do. People work second jobs so they can continue to be farmers. People don't work second jobs so they can continue to manufacture cars. People come back to help their families with the harvest or with the planting. People have people who have roots in agriculture have a love of the lifestyle, the culture. The current economic climate is driving agriculture towards more and more consolidation, fewer and fewer farmers, more and more decisions being made off the farm by agribusiness, more and more of the guidance that farmers receive is from people selling them inputs, so it's biased. And so this conflict between the culture of agriculture, the social side of agriculture, and the business side of agriculture is a fundamental conflict that that I think a lot about. My biggest concern about genetic modification is that it's being driven by a smaller and smaller number of players. Those companies are developing genetically modified crops principally because they see it as a way to dominate the marketplace, to capture their market share. But principally, what the companies have in mind is market domination. That's capitalism. But capitalism works, I think, most effectively when there is competition. And these companies have consolidated so greatly that we have a lack of competition. And we have diminishing choices for farmers. I think that there are genuine debates going on about the ethics of modifying genomes in ways that we aren't completely sure what is happening. There are genuine debates about whether whether species boundaries should be crossed. The food chain has such a high level of GMO products in it, and we simply don't have most parts of the food chain are not focused on identity preservation. The whole concept of a commodity is that it's undifferentiated. And so commodity crops generally are not identity preserved. There's little being done to keep one batch of soybeans from mixing with another batch of soybeans. Those are important issues, but in my mind, the biggest issue is the market domination, because it is antithetical to sustainability. Sustainability requires choice, it requires competition, and we are losing choices, we're losing competition, and I don't know whether antitrust legislation is the answer. I think that we need to have limited interference in the marketplace from government, but we need to have the right regulations. We need to have fair regulations that allow the marketplace to function, and I think we are unfortunately moving towards a less functional marketplace because such a small number of companies have such market power or market dominance.
After getting a better understanding of the human connection in agriculture, I sought to learn more about GMOs. Why are genetically modified organisms so popular among sectors of the scientific and corporate world? Can GMOs really be helpful? Can they produce food at a quicker rate? And is it safe? To find out, I flew out to Northern California and spoke with a professor from the University of California, Davis.
My name is Kent Bradford, and I'm a professor here in plant sciences at UC Davis. I'm also the director of the Seed Biotechnology Center in the College of Agricultural and Environmental Sciences here at UC Davis. Well, Davis has a history, as you say, of being a leader in agricultural technology, genetics and environmental aspects, management, many aspects of agriculture. In terms of the opportunities for genetic engineering, I think that they're enormous. I think we've only seen just the very start of what is potentially possible. In fact, in California is certainly not the biggest adopter of the products that we have so far. That is, the primary products that are available are in soybean, corn, cotton, and canola. Those are the major products. What the modern techniques enable us to do is not just bring wholesale changes from other species or from other crops, but in fact target very specific changes that would improve performance or properties that we want. Crops resistant to glyphosate or Roundup, which is fortunately one of the safest agricultural chemicals we have. That is, it's very effective in killing weeds and other plants, but it's extremely low toxicity to most other things, fortunately. 2,4-D is a very old herbicide that we have. It's very effective in certain cases. You probably may use it in a lawn weed killer. But if it's not manufactured properly, and in the large scale that it was being manufactured during Vietnam, there are adverse chemicals that can be in there, dioxin for one, that was particularly bad. Personally, I think we need more options. That is, the high reliance now on the few products we have that use glyphosate resistance has, in fact, leading to problems. That is, some of the weeds are becoming resistant. We know way before genetic engineering that we need to use different strategies, cultural, herbicide, rotations, all kinds of ways to battle weeds. And the success of that product has led it to be probably overused by farmers. And in fact, they need other options. They need other herbicides. Whether 2,4-D is the one, it does have some issues. It's a very broad spectrum. It can affect other crops and so on. In terms of public safety, all of these products are thoroughly tested by the EPA, and they're not released unless they can be used in a safe and reliable way. What we see down the pipeline are even much more important products, I think, which are those that would, for example, enhance tolerance to water stress or to the variability in water availability, to increase the total productivity, that is, enhancing the photosynthetic capacity, the ability of plants to actually produce carbon or fixed carbon. many of these achievements scientific approaches have already been shown in proof of concept, and we just need to be working toward enhancing them and enabling them to be used. In fact, we collaborate with many companies. We're members of the Agricultural Experiment Station, whose mission is to interact with our agricultural industries, and certainly seed suppliers and input agricultural suppliers are important to that. So I would say that, in fact, my view is that those groups should, in fact, be contributing much more. That is, why should we not ask those groups who benefit from scientific and technological advances to help pay for them? And working with those companies who are the ones who are integrating new technologies into the seed is exactly where we should be. That is, the seeds are the microchips of agriculture, in a sense. That is, that's the Intel inside of agriculture, because we can embody many improvements genetically, deliver it through a seed, which means we do not have to deliver it in other ways, that is, after the fact through pesticides or fertilizers or other ways. So, in fact, I think that it's the appropriate strategy that our high technology, in fact, interacts with those who will then incorporate that into varieties that are made available to farmers and enhance the overall productivity. If you walk down the cereal aisle or the packaged food aisle or many of the processed foods, you will find that a large fraction of those would contain some products made from genetically engineered foods. For example, anything that uses corn starch, corn oil, soybean protein, and so on. That is, those commodity substrates for processed foods largely come from genetically engineered crops, because in the U.S. About 90% of those crops are genetically engineered. But if you go down the produce aisle, the vegetable aisle, and fruits, very few. A few papayas and sometimes some squash, maybe some sweet corn. That is, it's very biased, in a sense, that if you eat mostly out of the vegetable side of the market, you won't be getting very many genetically engineered foods. If you eat mostly from the cereals and processed food side, then you will, but not in a direct form. That is, it's only as sugar or starch or those very highly refined processed products, which in fact, because they are refined, it really doesn't matter whether they come from a genetically engineered product or not. That is, it's starch, it's sugar, it's the same product no matter where it came from. Well, drought resistance is a huge target for all agricultural developers now, I think, and breeders. We know that we will probably be seeing more drought, or at least more variable rainfall, even in the Midwest. There are some products already being introduced and tested. My understanding is that in the recent droughts that we had in those tests, that they did show advantages, somewhere around 7% or so yield increases due to some of those products. I have a colleague at UC Davis, Eduardo Blumwald, who has developed crops that can show fairly remarkable resilience to drought. That is, they can suffer pretty extreme drought, and then when rainfalls come again, recover and go ahead and make decent yields. Certainly, any time you have water stress, you're going to lose yield. But the key point is, do you lose everything or get 30 or 40% of the projected yield, or can you recover 60 or 70 or 80%? And this makes a huge difference, and it would make a huge difference around the world. So contrary to what many people would say about how complex that is as a trade, it certainly is. My colleague, Dr. Blumwald, has shown that, in fact, just a single gene that he's introduced into a number of crops now are holding up in the field and showing that, in fact, we can remarkably increase the resilience of crops to drought. I'm not really opposed to labeling per se. That is, organic labeling, it goes through a certification process. They've met certain criteria, and it's really a brand. I think we need to clarify labeling versus branding. That is, Companies have the opportunity to brand them, their products in many ways. We can already brand crops or products as GM-free, for example, and there are those products in the market. What I did not agree with is to include that as a mandatory label on a product for no reason except that a certain group feels that they would like to know that. Now, certainly consumers have a right to know what's in their food when it's relevant. Now, if in fact food producers or supermarket chains or whoever decide that they would like to label those products, they can certainly do that. I'm still opposed to making it mandatory because I don't see that there's that significant a difference, again, between whether they're genetically engineered or they're modified in other ways. How many things about how food is produced could we eventually add to that label? Many people might want to know, well, how really was it fertilized? Was that harvested by a machine or was it harvested by a person? What was the, was it union labor or was it not union labor? In other words, there's all kinds of things that certain groups might feel that they would want to know about their food. So unfortunately, yes, I believe Europe made a wrong turn early on. And unfortunately, the consequences of that are going global. That is, Europe has a lot of influence on areas such as Africa and other parts of the world that, in fact, could enormously benefit from things that genetic engineering could bring if allowed, such as drought tolerance and improvements in disease resistance and other things that should really be non-controversial. And so Europeans can afford to do what they want, but exporting their anti-GM technology around the world, I think, is inappropriate. The current status quo is causing much more damage. In other words, I'll use another analogy. What would be the morality of saying, well, we have a vaccine for the disease that you have, but we won't let you have it because there's some fraction of a possibility that some people may have a bad reaction to it. This is a fact. Every vaccine we have, some people are sensitive to it. But in one in a million, we're willing to take that risk. With genetic engineering, many groups are not willing to take any risk. In other words, the pure precautionary principle that many cite wants zero risk whatsoever, no matter what the consequences of not employing that technology are. So how can we, you know, how could we stop not use a polio virus to stop a known problem? On the possibility that sometime in the future there might be possibly some negative. I mentioned also that these are in crop plants. This kind of idea that, well, once we do it, it's a total commitment, we'll never go back, that's not true. We change varieties all the time. If it turns out that some consequence of a particular product we don't like, we just quit using it, just like we do anything else. That is, this is not a once and for all thing. If we were to enable the scientists to really use this technology with proper safety concerns, of course, everything needs to be tested. But if we were enabled to use that, then we would have at least a chance of keeping up with the climate change, the population increases, and so on that are coming down the pike. We need to double food production in the next 30, 40, 50 years in the face of diminishing resources and climate change. And to tie our scientific hand behind our back in this field of food while allowing it to go forward in every other area of technology is not a future that I envision. Overall, I think the benefits greatly outweigh the potential disadvantages because so far none of those have actually materialized.
As GMOs continue to cultivate onto the nation's farmland and into our grocery stores, concerned Americans worry that consumption of genetically modified organisms could pose lingering effects not only on humans, but to the soil as well.
What do you have against GMOs? What concerns you the most about genetically modified organisms?
What concerns me is that they take genes from bacteria and viruses and inject them into plants with unknown repercussions. These genes that have taken millions of years to develop to encode for specific proteins are being messed with on this molecular level. We have absolutely no idea what we're doing. There's no way to control it. We don't know what the repercussions are going to be. And I'm really disappointed that our generation is to blame for releasing something like this.
What concerns you the most about genetically modified organisms?
What concerns me the most about it is the government and Monsanto lie about the effects of GMOs. What they do to people in the mid-90s when GMOs became very prevalent, the rises of diseases, autism, diabetes, cancer, heart disease, obesity, all are a direct correlation to the rise of genetically modified organisms.
What did you study in college, and what is it about drought? They say drought-resistant seeds help produce a stronger yield. It helps produce food during a drought. It would help feed the world during climate change. What do you say to that argument?
As an agronomist, I'm familiar with Atra. If you are interested in finding out the science about organic versus conventional, check out Atra Organic. They have some scientific studies in which they showed that organic farms in Central America and South America have been able to produce a yield in whenever there's extreme climate conditions, like in hurricanes and stuff like that. You can still produce food from your organic farms, whereas your conventional farms, which have no real soil stability or environmental stability, they just collapse and they don't produce anything in these. So, and the answer to drought and acidic soil is not making crops that are resistant to that. It's adjusting our own style and listening to the earth and listening to what the earth wants to grow there. So if we have acidic soil, then we need to grow blueberries or acidic-loving crops. If we have drought, then we need to start growing plants that are more resistant to drought, like rye and oats and stuff like that, and get rid of the wheat. It needs to be more intensive for the area, micromanagement.
I do not believe in altering seeds in any way possible. All seeds should be heirloom. They should not be altered in any way possible. It's been proven that Monsanto crops, when they are planted, over a period of years, their yield decreases and more fertilizers increase. And that will be proven the same with drought-resistant seeds.
And they, Monsanto will have certain seeds that are resistant to their herbicide sprays, so the farmers have to buy seed from them. Then they have to buy the herbicides and pesticides from them also. So it's kind of a monopoly, for one thing.
There's a chemical Monsanto's been talking about, 2,4-D, which was used in Agent Orange, and they add it into their Roundup Ready Xtends, and it goes into the food supply. In turn, we eat it. How damaging, from your research, are these chemicals that they put onto the soil that are supposedly trying to kill weeds?
So, they're in the business of death, first and foremost. That's what these chemicals do. They were originally made to be used in war, like in Vietnam, and before that, World War II, and after Vietnam, when they ran out of people to sell their chemicals to for killing people or for killing plants out in Vietnam, they turned to the agriculture market, and now they're putting these chemicals on our soil. And as far as persistence goes, well, they're there forever. And there's even studies that show that the GMO genes, that as we don't know what the repercussions from those are, they're showing up in soil-borne organisms, and those things work their way up through the food chain.
The chemicals they use, the pesticides and herbicides, are just extremely poisonous, and we can't help but get residue from that. And that most of the grain, the corn, is fed to livestock, and then we in turn get that residue in the meat products we buy.
And basically, as these smaller organisms consume the plants that are sprayed with the herbicides and stuff like that, and those say they're resistant and they survive, but they have contaminants now in their body, the birds then go and eat that, and the animals that eat the birds or so forth, it climbs all the way up the food chain to the humans, and these aluminum and heavy metals and toxic substances accumulate in us, especially whenever we consists our diet mainly of animals and stuff like that, which is why we need to eat more plants.
Genetically altering the food I eat, to me, just sounds wrong. I mean, despite even, I've read scientific research on it too, but just basically it does not sound right to me. I mean, I want to eat food that is fresh, local, that has not been altered with, that does not have extra chemicals, doesn't have hormones, that hasn't been genetically changed. So personally, that's just my feeling.
They want to label the products that have direct GMO ingredients, but animals which are fed GMO corn and soybean, and you'll see when you buy all natural beef or chicken, it says asterisk free range and all vegetarian fed, and all that means is that they just gave that animal access to a little 4x4 area of grass. And when it says vegetarian diet, that means they just fed them GMO corn and soybeans. So, Really, it's no different than just straight consuming the GMO corn. It actually may be more damaging for your body because these animals that have ingested this unnatural food, their immune systems are compromised, and yours can equally become compromised by consuming those animals.
When Proposition 37 came up in California, you can see that the number of companies, well, it's hard to see, but the number of companies who supported that fight by donating money so that that Proposition 37 would not pass, you can see there's major companies, Monsanto, of course, PepsiCo, Coca-Cola, and then some companies which I was really shocked, Cascadian Farms, R.W. Knudsen, Silk. I was really shocked to see those supposedly organic companies that did not support, you know, going against the GMOs. And then there's a list of companies that did work towards, you know, getting that. So you got to be careful what you buy. If you've got to buy with the companies who are doing the things that you believe in, and boycotting the other companies.
Why do you feel entities like the USDA or the FDA aren't doing anything? They say, oh, we want to do food safety, but in reality, they're not.
Well, the FDA and the EPA and all these government organizations are pretty much run by money, let's say that first and foremost, and Clarence Thomas, who wrote the deciding decision on the Supreme Court case, which gave them the right to own life, used to work for Monsanto. That's just one example of the ability of these companies to get on the inside and control these organizations that are supposed to represent us, the people, and it's time that we took them back.
That is extremely concerning to me, that basically a chemical company can have that much say in American politics and government. To me, it's just really alarming.
You're standing right behind the White House. Why hasn't the president, why hasn't Congress done anything against Monsanto? They, they play the hand of, oh, we're trying to do something on food safety. Yet, there's a lot of concerns about GMOs and very little testing done on the health effects of GMOs. Why hasn't the president, why hasn't Congress done anything to look into GMOs?
Money. That's the bottom line, money. They all get, the lobbyists are rampant in Congress. President Obama has appointed Tom Vilsack, Secretary of Agriculture, former of the year in Iowa by Monsanto. He has Michael Taylor as his food czar, who is an executive from Monsanto. He has Elena Kagan on the Supreme Court, who has written a brief in support of Monsanto, and we have Bowman versus Supreme Court going in a couple of weeks. She will not recuse herself. It's about money. They're all in this together.
The public outcry has grown louder and louder over the last few years, expressing their concerns over the safety of GMOs, and more specifically, drought-resistant seeds. But are they that harmful? Can a drought-resistant seed produce food with little to no water at all? I decided to find out while attending the USDA Agriculture Outlook Forum just outside of Washington, D.C., where I was able to speak with professionals in the industry.
Julio, Rausseo, how has drought-resistant seeds changed in the market? What type of trends do you see drought-resistant seeds going in the next year or next few years if the drought trend continues in parts of the Midwest? And for the CME side, for weather derivatives, how could a farmer or trader looking at, say, potentially another current drought trend, how could one manage weather derivatives for a farmer if they want to protect their farmland from another terrible drought season?
I can take an initial crack at that. This is an area of very active debate among crop scientists and others, in particular for corn. Are our GMO varieties with the stack traits in particular much more drought resistant than the varieties that preceded these stack trait hybrids. My own view from the research that we've done is that while that technology has certainly contributed to our continued growth in trend corn yields, that their impact on in terms of drought tolerance is fairly small. Evidence of that would be we have a crop weather model that we use, and in fact, our predictions with that model based on data for the last 50 years were too high without taking into account any changes in trend due to drought tolerance. So I don't think the evidence is very convincing that our current hybrids have all that much better drought tolerance than they had, say, 15 or 20 years ago. We may have seen a bit of an uptick, a small uptick in the rate of growth in corn trend yields, but I don't think it's been large. We're not going to get to 300 bushels per acre anytime soon. On the other hand, science does progress, and I think that you can be more optimistic as you look further down the road with some of the genetic technologies that are in the laboratory and starting to be field tested, that maybe we can see some more progress as we look down maybe a 5, 10, 15 year horizon into the future. The problem with drought tolerance is that it's incredibly difficult to pinpoint the changes in the plant to make it more drought tolerant, because just like last summer, if you get a 2 or 3 week blast of scorching heat in just the wrong period, and that's not the time period that you've timed your drought tolerance characteristics in the corn plant, it's worthless. So it's very hard to make a general change in the plant genetics that will make it more drought tolerant.
I would just add, there is some technology out there, right? So it's coming out, it's adopting. You hear statistics around 6 bushel per acre, 10, 12, depending upon how you do your math, yield increase when in drought-stricken areas. So I think that, it's like many of the technologies that come, it's going to come. I think that they will figure out a way to do it, and it solves two things at one time. It solves a growing need for food, and it solves the water resource relative to that growing need for food. So if it can get done and if it can be effective, I would say it will be good. I would also add that, what you heard this morning regarding to synchronous approvals worldwide are a big deal for the industry, and making sure that as we roll these products out, we're able to use those and access markets worldwide that want to take them. So I would just say, as these new things come out, there'll be a lot of dialogue coming on about how fast they're adopted, where they're adopted, and how we do that, all towards an increase in technology. Because if you remember the yield chart, without that, we're going to have a hard time feeding the world.
So I'm Dave Bodler. I'm with Cargill in Minneapolis, and I'm here as part of the forum, the panel, that just talked about markets and the relationship of markets to the different companies, CME, ourselves, and University of Illinois. This topic of drought tolerance and doing that is an important issue in a dry year like we're just coming off of. This will be a big issue relative to the crop we just got done with, and if we have adequate rainfall, a drought-resistant crop will be less important. But as we encourage crops to go west on corn production, drought tolerance in those areas will be important for the producer to be able to reduce their risk of a crop failure.
Following this summer, we've heard more and more news about drought resistant seeds or drought tolerant seeds. Could you explain a little bit about what is a drought resistant seed and how long this sort of product has been in development?
Yeah, it's a seed that grows a plant that in a stressed year requires less moisture or performs better in a dry year that protects them against that. So this is technology that's coming out through genetic engineering. It's technology that the farmer is very interested in because it reduces his or her risk in planting. So it's coming out, it's to protect in the bad years, and the good products will come out without any drag on good years when they do have adequate moisture, that they're still able to have their high yielding crops in those years as well.
What is the difference, say, from a drought-resistant seed compared to a regular or organic type of seed? Are there differences? Are there any similarities?
So it's a seed to grow a plant that uses less water. Yes, it's most of them that are coming out are genetically engineered. Whether it's genetically engineered or a hybrid, has also created a lot of solutions for farmers around risk protection and increasing yields. So it's one of the many things coming out to the farmers to be able to increase production. So it is in a different area than the organic space, and it'll be a choice for what the farmers incented to plant.
Some may be concerned about drought-resistant seeds or genetic engineering of food, that it may be unsafe to eat. What's the other side of the argument? How safe is genetic engineering of food, and what type of trend will we see genetic engineering of food in the future?
I think that the important thing is that we keep the conversation and the facts fact-based. So if we use science and fact-based, that's going to be the key to make sure that we have good products out there for people to use.
And then finally, looking at the drought, if, you know, Lord willing, that we don't have a drought and things go back to relative normal, will there still be a market for drought-tolerant seeds? And if not, what will a bounce back be?
Since it's hard to predict what the next year will be, there'll probably be some market for that. When it's resonant in the producer's mind from last year, there's probably a hotter market than there'll be after 3 years of great crops. If it's at a big premium to plant, you'll probably see less participation. But they've all been through a drought one year or another, and they'll respond.
It's clear that both sides will agree to disagree on this subject. Yet, where's the government? What's our elected officials and those in the administration stance? Are they listening to the concerns of the public or listening to the guidance of the agriculture industry? An executive from the United Nations saw GMO seeds as one alternative to feed third world nations.
Now, there are companies, food companies out there like Monsanto or Cargill, Pioneer, Dow, where they're actually going one step further, producing seeds for corn, soy, wheat that are resistant to drought. Do you see that as something being beneficial to help farmers in, not just here in America, but throughout the world, be able to produce food despite the drought?
Yes, we need seeds which are resistant, drought resistant. We need it. But it's not the only response. It must be holistic. The response must be holistic. As you, I have said, the vulnerability to drought is about, in many cases in Africa, is about rural poverty and desertification. If the land is degraded, you're likely not to make much out of your drought-resistant seed. So the response must be global. It must be holistic. And, of course, research to have improved seed are part of it.
U.S. Representative Tim Huelskamp embraced genetic modification when I posed the question to him.
Would you be in favor of labeling non-genetically modified foods compared to genetically modified foods? There's been a big debate going on. Monsanto has been a big lobbyist in Capitol Hill to restrict the labeling of genetically modified foods. Are you in favor of giving the people a choice to wonder what is GMO and what's non-GMO?
Well, a lot of times and I'm a farmer myself, and they use those products, and I think they are perfectly safe, and there's obviously some environmental groups that use scare tactics about that, and numerous others. So, but I say let the market, if folks want to see that and they want to pay a lot more for organic, I mean, they will have that identified. And most of what we use has been genetically enhanced at various times. I mean, the ability of folks in particularly environmentalist movement to misuse and mislead folks. I'll give you a perfect example of that is this issue of lean, finely textured beef. And you might have heard about that. Folks, because of misinformation coming out of one television outlet, I think it was CBS News, ran 30 consecutive stories that was full of bad science, misinformation. And in my district, they eliminated 250 jobs and said, go home. And they shut down a plant. There were four plants around the country. I'll tell you today, lean, finely textured beef was the safest beef you could buy in the entire country because of the innovative process by which they killed E. coli. But don't let science get in the facts, folks in Washington and in many of these movements. And so everything needs to be fact-based, but let consumers have those particular choices.
And recently, Montana Senator John Tester was vocal on the Senate floor in his stance against Washington favoring the agriculture industry.
It's time to highlight the need for greater transparency and openness so voters can hold their elected leaders accountable and for what happens here in Washington, D.C., and to just know what's going on. The second provision sent over from the House tells the USDA to ignore any judicial ruling regarding the planting of genetically modified crops. Its supporters are calling it farmer assurance provision. But all it really assures is a lack of corporate liability. The provision says that when a judge finds that the USDA approved a crop illegally, the department must reapprove the crop and allow it to continue to be planted, regardless of what the judge says. Now let's think about that. The United States Congress is telling the Agricultural Department that even if a court tells you that you've failed to follow the right process and tells you to start over, you must disregard the court's ruling and allow the crop to be planted anyway. Not only does this ignore the Constitution idea of separation of powers, but it also lets genetically modified crops take hold across this country, even when a judge finds it violates the law. Once again, agribusiness, multinational corporations, putting farmers as serfs. It's a dangerous precedent. Mr. President, it will paralyze the USDA, putting the department in the middle of a battle between Congress and the courts. And the ultimate loser will be our family farmers going about their business and feeding America in the right way. Sunshine Week shouldn't be show and tell, Mr. President, and slipping corporate giveaways into a bill at the same time that we call for more open government is doubling down on the same policies that created the need for Sunshine Week in the first place. That's why I've introduced two amendments to remove these corporate welfare provisions from the bill. Montana's elected me to go to the Senate to do away with the shady backroom deals, to get rid of handouts to big corporations, and to make government work better. We still have many challenges in front of us. And I commend the leaders of the Appropriation Committee for their commitment to working together to bring us on a plan we can vote. But these two provisions undermine our good work to support family farm agriculture. These provisions are giveaways, pure and simple, and will be a boon worth millions of dollars to a handful of the biggest corporations in this country. They deserve no place in this bill. We simply have got to do a better job on both policy and process.
But what about USDA? Should they look into the safety issues of GMOs? Or were the activists correct and the USDA will side with the agriculture corporations? I decided to ask Secretary Tom Vilsack myself in the middle of his press conference.
Secretary, you mentioned about the drought, your concerns about the drought, especially in the Midwest. With drought-resistant seeds being discussed more out in the open, how will USDA go forth with drought-resistant technology? And secondly, huge concerns throughout the country on the safety of GMOs for human consumption. What can USDA do to address those concerns? And similar to the USDA organic labeling, could we see someday down the road a USDA GMO labeling to address those concerns?
Well, you asked a lot of questions there. I'll try to answer several of them. First of all, USDA's role relative to any kind of seed technology is to ensure that it doesn't create a hazard or a danger to plants and to crops. And that's the regulatory process that we go through. Folks who come up with new technology, we basically work through that process of ensuring the safety and security of that technology. And when we're convinced that they don't represent the threats under the Plant Protection Act, we deregulate. That's a process that takes a considerable period of time and a lot of data and a lot of research. I don't know of any reputable study at this point that suggests that there's a safety concern relative to health with GE crops. And that's the reason why they are utilized by American farmers. And that's one of the reasons why we were able to get through a drought in better shape than we had anticipated. And it's one of the reasons why we've seen extraordinary productivity gains, as Senator Daschle alluded to. That regulatory process, I think, it needs to we constantly look at ways in which we can improve the process, but the bottom line is making sure that what is deregulated is not presenting a threat to plants and crops. As far as labeling is concerned, let me just simply say that historically, labeling in this country has been about two issues: nutrition, providing nutritional information, and about safety issues. I'm sure that either one of those fits your question. I don't think it's not about nutrition, and I don't know that there's a reputable study relative to safety. So at this point, I don't know that we're necessarily headed down at USDA a path.
All the changes that are taking place to agriculture, to our communities, to the ocean, and so forth, then we're just ignoring what science is telling us. So I will be a passionate advocate about this, but not based on ideology, based on facts, based on science. And I hope to sit with all of you and convince you this $6 trillion market is worth millions of American jobs and leadership, and we better go after it.
We need proactive solutions. We need strategies to manage and mitigate climate change and the impacts of climate change. The majority has to deal with this question. It cannot be ignored. The Safe Climate Caucus has challenged the majority to a floor debate on climate change. We look forward to that opportunity. And for the sake of the Colorado River, that debate needs to happen. Heel back.
Changes in the world's climate are at this point inevitable. It's already happening and affecting our communities, and we can expect these impacts to intensify and accelerate as climate continues to change. In my view, we need to accept these facts and modify our behavior to prevent these effects from becoming cumulatively catastrophic. We can make better choices now to prevent a disaster later.
But looking at the likelihood of these extreme weather events, that's something domestic constituencies can relate to. Mm-hmm. They can relate to poor people waiting for aid to rebuild or recover after Sandy. There are still hundreds of thousands of people displaced from Hurricane Katrina. And people have a natural sympathy and let's do something. Let's prevent this from happening.
President Obama's right up the street here. And if he takes strong executive action using his regulatory and administrative powers, that can change the equation for the polluters, where suddenly it now makes sense for them to come up to Congress and to start working with us rather than just operating by the principle of the Stonewall.
The debate rages as climate change, along with genetically modified organisms, have become the hot-button environmental issues. Politicians in Washington are seeking to prevent a climate catastrophe, but is that possible? Can Congress, which has a hard time balancing its budget, save the public from climate change? One investigative reporter has zero faith.
I'm Mark Marano, the publisher at Climate Depot, one of the most hated climate skeptics out there. I just won the Misinformer of the Year award by Media Matters, the global warming activists.
You just mentioned you've been labeled a skeptic, Misinformer of the Year. What comes to your mind when you hear those type of things? Do you find it laughable? Do you take it as a badge of honor?
Yeah, it's a sort of badge of honor. It's fun. I mean, it's silly. What they're saying essentially is, if you hold the view that you're a global warming skeptic, you're a flat earther, you're akin to a Holocaust denier. And so if you go out on TV and say it, and you say it publicly, and you have a website, and you write articles, then they're like even in more horror. So they just think that you're basically an idiot, and that's, you're a smart, intelligent person if you believe, have the faith to believe in this modern day science. This is government, politically correct funded science. It's not to say that every scientist is on the take or altering data, but if you study butterflies, no one's gonna pay attention to you if you're just doing studies on butterflies and their habitat. But if you do a study saying, hey, if the temperature were to rise 6 degrees by 2075 in the Northeast, what impact would that have on butterflies? Suddenly you're gonna get university press releases, you're gonna get media coverage, you're gonna get more funding, you're gonna get published in more prestigious journals, people are gonna sit up and pay attention, and all you would do is come up with a range of possibilities, different temperature ranges, possible butterfly impacts. Suddenly this scientist who never studied whether CO2 impacts climate or how it impacts climate is now feeding by the global warming establishment as they had another scientist in the consensus, when all he was really doing was benefiting from all this money. The government throws all this money into this research, foundations, research, all the journals, all the governments around the world, the United Nations are directing it. Suddenly all this money and all these scientists, well, if you're going to, let's do climate. Hey, let's just study climate now. Let's get into this. This is the hot thing at the moment. Any bad things will happen with global warming. Well, guess what? Bad things happen all the time with weather. So now every time a bad thing happens, as you would expect it to do, it's further proof of their theory. There's no way to falsify the theory anymore. One scientist said it's now akin to the predictions of Nostradamus, where there's these cryptic messages. We now have the Mayan calendar. This is what it's basically like. It's the end of time with the Mayan calendar. James Hansen, NASA's lead global warming scientist, is practicing his own form of a Mayan calendar. In January 2009, he said Obama had 4 years left to save the Earth. Guess what? It expires, I believe, tomorrow, that 4 years that he gave Obama. So we have our NASA scientist issuing his own Mayan-like end-of-the-world calendar.
The global warming movement picked up a lot of steam, and it seemed like there was going to be consensus on some sort of treaty at the United Nations conference in Copenhagen, Denmark. And then the events of Climategate, as it's now known, really derailed everything. You're in Copenhagen. What was the reaction of the entire UN conference? And number two, what did Climategate do back in 2009 to derail this whole movement?
Yeah, I think it helped derail, because what I like to say is before Climategate, particularly in the U.S., people didn't buy this. I mean, it was a study by Gallup. More people believed in haunted houses than man-made global warming, 37% to 36%. If you look at what happened in Copenhagen, there was a lot of high hope. People thought we were finally going to follow up and have this new treaty and a mission eliminating. We were going to control the thermostat. This was modern world leaders getting together, talking about limiting the Earth's temperature, a verbal non-binding agreement. That's what they ended up with, to limit the Earth's temperature to no more than 2 degrees Celsius rise. Imagine, and then we laugh at witch doctors and we laugh at the ancient people who thought they could control the weather or slaughter people to control the weather. Here we think that acts of Congress, the United Nations, can control the Earth's thermostat. So in Copenhagen, Obama showed up, strolled into a room, tried to make something happen. Then he had to hightail it out of Copenhagen because there was a huge blizzard hitting Washington, D.C., which, of course, is consistent with what they predicted, even though they never predicted blizzards and extreme cold. But, hey, any weather event's consistent because it's because they said there would be big storms and records broken. Well, records are broken all the time. Obama was actually given a large share of the blame. At that conference, there were protesters outside the conference screaming, "Obama, shame on you." They had pictures of Obama with the phrase "climate shame" on them. And so partially what happened was Climategate broke right before that, and it took the leaders and the political will of the leaders took a battering, because that was all over the grassroots in America, throughout Europe. It was a huge scandal. And essentially Climategate showed us that the upper echelon of the United Nations, the head lead scientists, were colluding to keep out studies that were inconvenient, keep out data that was inconvenient, and they were crafting a grand narrative. That's what the whole thing was about. All these UN scientists were crafting a narrative of what they wanted to say. It was preordained. They knew what they were going to say. When this science became bastardized in 1988, when the UN formed this climate panel, the IPCC, they essentially had to say CO2 impacts climate. If they fail to find that, then they fail to have a reason to exist, to fail to have a reason to even exist as an entity. So they're never going to find that. And you'll even hear the UN IPCC chairman, Rajendra Bachari, be like Babe Ruth. He'll tell you what the next report. Just wait till the next report. It'll be so alarming, policymakers will have to act. Well, what kind of science is that where the guy calls it out years ahead of time, what it's going to say, and then what impact they wanted to have? This is a political process masquerading as a science body. It's an insult to everyone's intelligence. The governing boards, 2 dozen or so governing board members, politically correct, with connections to politics in Washington, of these big groups, National Academy of Science, American Meteorological, will go along with it in their statements. No direct vote of members, no direct input of their members. And then they're saying, hey, thousands of scientists endorse the UN. No, 2 dozen governing board members do. If you look at surveys, in the case of the American Meteorological Society, up to 75% of their members were hostile, many of them calling global warming a hoax, but yet their leaders, 2 dozen governing board members, say they are in complete lockstep with the UN and they therefore make up the consensus. It's a con. If Congress wants them to say global warming is a problem, by golly, Congress has paid them to say it. This is no longer science. This is politics masquerading as science.
You've gone to a lot of these UN climate conferences. Explain to those who think these conferences are just serious negotiating talks. You mentioned you've gone to Rio de Janeiro, you've gone to Cancun, you've gone to all these different exotic places. Why do they have these conferences? conferences in exotic locations, and what are they all about?
For the same reason I go. You know, we had them in, they're having this year's in Poland. I don't think I'm going to go to Poland in December. It doesn't excite me. Now, they've had them in Cancun. They've had them in Bali. They've had them in, when I went to Kenya on the U.S. taxpayer dime, $16,000 round trip airfare business class paid for by U.S. taxpayers via the State Department. I went on a safari. I got to go to the U.N. conference. They go to these, when I went to Bali, paid for by the U.S. taxpayer, five-star resort on the water in Bali, nicer than any Hawaiian resort you could imagine, or at least as nice as any Hawaiian resort. This is why many Senate staffers went. This is why politicians like to go. This is why U.N. delegates, bureaucrats, why all the media likes to go. They know how to throw a party. When I was in Johannesburg, South Africa, they were having a summit on sustainable development and how to help poor people and the energy of the world to develop so we help poor people and not harm the earth. Well, they flew in chefs from Europe. They were doing caviar and shrimp and all kinds of exotic meats and wines and champagnes, and they interviewed the chefs and how they all the world leaders were demanding all this exotic food while they sat there and talked about the plight of the poor. Here's what's overblown. Here's what's forgotten in all this is that there is climate change if you just take it as a generic term, i.e. extreme weather, weather events not caused by man but naturally, has always been a danger to mankind. We should always be concerned about hurricanes, tornadoes, floods, droughts. But the idea that we're causing it, the idea that our SUVs have turned into a weather machines, that we have the control knob and we can turn them up or down, or that we can pass a cap and trade or a carbon tax, and somehow, as Barbara Boxer says, we must pass the cap and trade bill or we'll have worse floods, hurricanes, and droughts. They actually believe that we can control the weather. It's patently absurd. The bottom line is what Obama's poised to do is start regulating CO2. We inhale oxygen, exhale CO2 as a pollutant under the Clean Air Act. There's going to be lawsuits. There's going to be all kinds of delays. Congress is going to try to stop it. I don't know to what effect. In addition to that, there's talk of tax reform occurring, and as part of that, a revenue-neutral carbon tax being put in. As the Washington Post said, it will help fight global warming, and it'll bring in, I can't remember the number, $150 billion a year. You think Washington's more interested in fighting global warming through a tax or bringing in $150 billion a year? So that's, and of course, it's carbon neutral because they'll offset, lower some other tax temporarily for a year or so, but what that ultimately means is Washington will have yet another tool in the toolbox that they'll have to tax. They'll have a carbon tax, which they can raise at will. They'll have other taxes, which will initially be offset, which they'll raise again. And then they'll say that somehow they're saving the planet. So those are the biggest threat. EPA regulations and a carbon tax loom.
Some scientists have some really interesting ways to combat climate change. Cloud seeding, climate engineering, carbon taxes. They even go as far as advocating plastic trees to absorb CO2. What are your thoughts when you hear scientists talk about manipulating the weather and doing all these weird things to help save the earth?
Well, Obama's energy secretary wanted to paint roofs white so that we could cool the earth. You know, I don't even cover geoengineering, what you're discussing, on my website because I think it's so patently absurd and a waste of time. Carbon capture and sequestration, we need to do all this nonsense of everything they're trying to do is an utter futile waste of time. Not about black carbon and soot having, you know, many times the impact on climate that they ever knew. The idea that science is settled. Well, you have new peer-reviewed studies throwing that out just this week. And so what happens is hundreds of factors influence climate, and the idea that CO2 is the tail that wags the dog isn't tenable in the scientific literature. How do we know that? We look at all the other factors, everything from volcanic dust to ocean cycles to the sun, the solar system, cloud feedbacks, and then you look at the past. The medieval warm period, both northern and southern hemisphere globally, was as warm or warmer than current temperatures without benefit of SUVs. So the idea that we're driving a catastrophe isn't held up in the literature. And if you look at the CO2 has been many times higher in the past, we've been cooler, and it's been many times lower, and we've been warmer. The idea that CO2 is a control knob doesn't bear out.
In the discussion on how to combat climate change, one of the options discussed is a controversial proposal ripped from the pages of science fiction. The concept of deliberately interfering with the climate isn't a brand new idea. In fact, the idea of weather modification was spearheaded in the U.S. by the United States military. But is weather modification a smart idea? Should we be deliberately interfering with the Earth's climate? One woman says no.
My name is Rosalind Peterson, and I'm from Mendocino County, California. And my whole life has been involved in some form or another of agriculture crop production, from working for the Mendocino County agricultural department for 5 years as an agricultural technologist. Then I worked for the California Department of Agriculture, the state of California, Farm Service Agency, several in the state of California, as well as I am a certified crop loss adjuster for the state of California. I haven't worked in that capacity for many years, but it is one of the reasons that I became interested in a topic called geoengineering. Geoengineering is the large-scale manipulation of the Earth's environment, the atmosphere, the oceans, the Earth itself, in order to supposedly change or mask global warming. There are any number of schemes, from ocean iron fertilization, which hasn't worked well, all the way to plans for solar radiation management, which means putting particles or chemicals in the atmosphere to reduce the amount of direct sunlight reaching the Earth. In 2009 and 2010, the UK Parliament and the US House of Representatives Science and Technology Committee met three times in the United States and in England, and the reason that they met was to discuss geoengineering and global geoengineering governance, and also to work together toward finding some rules for geoengineering that would be followed, probably without any public oversight, public consent, prior public notification, or any other issues that the public might need to know in order to protect the environment.
How long have you been involved in doing research on geoengineering, and what made you get involved to look into the subject?
I started realizing that there were atmospheric testing and other things going on in the atmosphere that were going to cause problems for agriculture, crop production, photosynthesis, and some other issues with regard to agriculture. And so in 2002, I started doing research. Geoengineering started to come onto the horizon and be spoken about in the mid-2000s, about 2004, 2005, and then more and more you'd see more articles. And finally, there were these hearings by the U.S. House of Representatives. And I was concerned that the particles and chemicals, sulfur or aluminum oxide that were being proposed by several university professors, a small clique of men who are bound and determined to conduct different kinds of atmospheric geoengineering programs without public consent or oversight or any knowledge ahead of time of these proposals so that people can take action. And these gentlemen started to be proponents of putting particles and chemicals into the atmosphere without consideration of the effects, the negative effects. Well, one of the things about solar radiation management is that when you put particles and chemicals into the atmosphere, they're going to have effect on ozone. They're going to have an effect on cloud formation. They're going to have an effect on the amount of direct sunlight reaching the Earth. And when you're talking about curing global warming, supposedly, by reducing the amount of direct sunlight reaching the Earth, we know that isn't true. The second thing is, when you reduce the amount of direct sunlight reaching the Earth, you're going to lower crop production. You're going to have incidences of lack of vitamin D, because if direct sunlight doesn't come down to the Earth and touch the Earth, we won't absorb enough vitamin D through our skin in order to lead healthy lives and for our children to lead healthy lives. So we've got the CDC, the University of California, Berkeley, we've got Kaiser Permanente, a large health system agency, all making the statements that we're suffering now from a lack of vitamin D because of increasing cloud cover. And one form of geoengineering is caused by persistent jet contrails. And according to NASA, these contrails turn into man-made clouds. They're composed of jet fuel emissions and water vapor, which is a highly potent greenhouse gas. And the aviation impacts are reducing the amount of direct sunlight through haze and man-made cloud cover. And when you reduce the amount of direct sunlight, then, and you increase the clouds, you not only change the climate itself, but what you do in this type of geoengineering project is that you reduce the sunlight reaching the Earth, you have lower solar panel power production, you have a lowering of crop production because direct sunlight causes plants to grow healthy and strong due to the photosynthesis process. You begin to also exacerbate global warming in areas like Alaska and the Arctic because with clear skies, heat will evaporate away from the Earth. But when you put in man-made cloud cover, according to NASA and Stanford University studies and other research, you are beginning to trap the heat and you make certain areas warmer, and so therefore they artificially warm. And this impacts our climate, and it changes the Earth's atmosphere enough so that we're seeing the direct effect of climate change from aviation impacts. In addition to those impacts, we have weather modification programs, about 66 of them ongoing in the United States, and about 169 ongoing worldwide. These programs change local weather conditions, they change the climate, and they're either ground-based or they use small planes in order to initiate these type of weather modification programs. Private corporations, private individuals, even myself, if I hired a weather modification company, I could enhance the snowfall somewhere, wherever I wanted. Now, California, Texas, Idaho, Colorado, Kansas, New Mexico is being impacted by weather modification programs in the country of Mexico and also from the Texas weather modification programs. A lot of states are involved, and one weather modification program can change and be implemented over 186,000 square miles. These are huge in scope and dimension. David Keith and Ken Caldera, professors from different parts of the country, talk about using sulfur. Well, they took sulfur out of diesel fuel a couple of years ago in California because of asthma and acid rains that impacted our forests. And yet, they turn around and say, well, we could add sulfur to the atmosphere. Well, sulfur has reproductive toxicity according to the California EPA. Sulfur exacerbates asthma in children, causes acid rains, causes streams and rivers to acidify. And we're talking about putting sulfur into the atmosphere in geoengineering schemes. One is upcoming in 2013, for New Mexico. They want to conduct, David Keith wants to conduct a project there, but doesn't want to tell us when for fear that we may object in advance and he might not be able to conduct the experiment. So this is where we have a problem with allowing atmospheric experiments and also understanding that tree decline just isn't a function of one thing, bugs or drought. It's a function of many things that are going on atmospherically. They don't want the public to have any invite into the conversation on this. And this is where we need to take action to have an invite into this conversation and to set the rules or to say no before these programs are implemented. And when someone tells me that they want to play God with our environment, but they don't want any rules or any restrictions and they want to do it in secret, then I have growing concerns because I think it's just for prestige and to make money. I don't know that necessarily it's going to benefit you and me and my grandchildren and other people.
Is Rosalind correct? Do geoengineers want the public to be unaware of their climate-changing programs? Does geoengineering and weather modification pose a significant risk to the public and environment? And are these programs given full consent from government? While covering the Climate Forward rally in Washington, D.C., I posed that question to Rhode Island Senator Sheldon Whitehouse.
With the dangers of climate change, there's been some talks from scientists and even it's been looked at by Congress of ways of trying to potentially stop climate change through climate engineering or cloud seeding. Could that be a way that Congress could try to put more funds in research and development to see that as a way to stop climate change?
Yeah, the whole question of geoengineering is, first of all, it's a little bit dangerous. It's not nice to mess with Mother Nature, remember that old phrase? And the second thing is that geoengineering misses half of the problem. It misses the ocean half of the problem. Enormous amount of the carbon that we emit gets absorbed by the oceans. The oceans just chemically become more acidic as a result. And you can try to offset the temperature effects of our carbon pollution. But if the ocean continues to get acider and acider, it's going to be more and more challenging for our planet and for our species.
What about the president? Would his administration endorse a geoengineering program?
Various university scientists are considering techniques such as climate engineering, cloud seeding as a way to help prevent extreme weather. Is that something the president may look into with research and development?
On the geoengineering side, this climate engineering side, look, this is something that people have been talking about for a while, this idea that if you can't stop adding to the greenhouse gas that traps heat inside the planet, or inside the atmosphere, you might take steps to block some of that heat from coming in the first place. It's an extreme set of measures. I think some people would like to pretend that set of options doesn't exist. Others would like to see more activity on it so at least we understand it, both technically but also internationally, so that one country doesn't go ahead and do it by itself. Right now, I think sort of institutions on the periphery of the government are taking the lead on this, the National Academy of Sciences, for example, and others. But I wouldn't expect to see a large push from inside this administration. It would raise an enormous amount of controversy.
Now that the senator admits Congress has looked into this issue, what about government organizations that deal specifically with weather? While attending a severe weather seminar put together by a Chicago television station, the director of the National Weather Service admits weather modification research has taken place, but denies present-day operation.
It's a rare opportunity to ask the director of the National Weather Service some questions. Louis had agreed to come if we allowed some questions. Do you have questions for Louis? And if so, please stand up, and Louis, you can recognize
him. There was a hand way up in the back.
Yes, I had a question with the high-resolution satellite imagery able to look at the National Weather Service. Is there any way you could detect whether a weather modification experiment is taking place or cloud seeding? I know in Kansas and Northern California that takes place, and as well as Idaho. Is there any way you can see that in a satellite? And is there a way to communicate that to the public, or do meteorologists have a duty to tell the public about weather modification?
Yeah. So I'm not aware of any cloud seeding that was going on for this. I can tell you that in the 70s, there was a Project Storm Fury that people started experimenting with seeding hurricanes way out in the Atlantic. And at that point, there were two things that happened. First of all, they had a small sample size, so they couldn't really determine anything with any kind of statistical significance of whether they were having an impact or not. For those scientists who, so the second thing that happened was for those scientists who claimed they were having an impact, the areas that were subsequently impacted by those storms were ready to sue those scientists. That experiment was ended. So there are, I know there's weather modification that's done under very controlled circumstances, especially out in the West for water resource purposes. In the East, there was some work that was done in Pennsylvania. And again, if people were claiming that they were successfully deriving more rainfall out of a system for the western part of the state, the farmers in the eastern part of the state said that was rainfall that would have fallen over us.
Yeah.
And then they started having that kind of battle within the state, and that ended. So it's a very tricky, controversial area, but in real time, We know of no one that was out there doing any kind of seeding.
And my question is, I've looked at what they call HAMP, or the Hurricane Modification Program that Homeland Security has talked about, and I know there are actually electric companies like the PG&E, Pacific Gas, an electric company in Northern California that conducts cloud seeding experiments. As a meteorologist, if you can see that on the radar, is it possible to maybe let the public know, oh, there's cloud seeding here in the area, just
well,
be cautious?
Let's put it this way. Cloud seeding now is done more by private sector, and they don't tell you when they're doing it because they consider it proprietary.
Okay.
So we do not factor in that type of activity into either our analysis or forecasting. We're just not even made aware of when it's happening. And it's mostly now focused in the western part for water resources.
Right.
But no, it doesn't play a role in our forecast process.
And then I've looked at what they've called geoengineering or climate engineering, literally modifying the weather to prevent climate change. Do you think that's something that is going to be done on a research basis, or if it's done, it has to be stringently looked at?
I really don't. First of all, again, if people doing that research, I'm not really aware of it, so I'm not even sure I can answer the question. I know that there are people who continue to talk about, they'll propose, like the nuclear, Tom mentioned, let's set off nuclear explosions and we can destroy a hurricane.
Right. Yeah, I've heard they talked about wanting to do volcanic eruptions.
Or send missiles into tornadoes.
What would you like, an exploding tornado?
Right.
Just make things worse.
So it's not enough.
Yeah, the modifications I think are more, and this is not my center of expertise, but long-term modifications of environments by planting trees and changing slow modification of ecosystems in a responsible manner sometimes may over time
or not
help
or don't,
offset
or don't cut down the forest
don't cut down
the forest.
They take in carbon dioxide but you're talking about vast energy scales, so to make significant impacts on them,
because I know there is conducted cloud seeding experiments taking place. Is it, do you think that's more private corporations that are doing it for research purposes?
I think cloud seeding is. I'm not that familiar, but I don't know of any government programs dealing in that.
Okay.
It's pretty much, that was...
Project Cern Fleury, way back?
Yeah. Oh, there's nothing like that, that's for sure.
Is the director of the National Weather Service oblivious to the current day weather modification programs taking place? Or is he covering up a program that the public should not know about? In the end, I've come to find out that several forms of modification are taking place, from the genetic modification of our food supply to the engineering of Earth's climate, both presented as solutions to fight climate change. Both may lead us into a situation we can't come back from. Both could lead us into a genetically modified society.
Isn't that amazing?